Good morning and welcome to the 26th meeting of the Rural Affairs and Islands Committee in 2023. We have apologies from Rhoda Grant, who is unable to make the start of the meeting, but is hopefully going to join us approximately 10 a.m. Before we begin, can I remind those members using electronic devices to switch them to silent. Our first item of business today is to decide whether to take item 3 in private. Are we all agreed? Thank you. We now have an evidence session on the Welfare of Dogs Scotland Bill, and I welcome to the meeting Gillian Martin, the Minister for Energy and Environment, and her officials, Andrew Voss, the Veterinary Head of Animal Welfare, and Stuart Forsyth, Animal Health and Welfare Policy Advisor. And also welcome to the meeting Christine Graham, MSP, as a member in charge of the bill. We have approximately 90 minutes scheduled for this session, and I'd like to invite the Minister to make an opening statement.
Thank you very much, Convener. I welcome the opportunity to contribute to your evidence sessions on Christine Graham's Welfare of Dogs Scotland Bill. And as we all know, animal welfare is an important but also a very emotive issue. The government takes animal welfare very seriously and is committed to the highest possible welfare standards. So we welcome Ms Graham's effort in this area and support the general principles of her bill. We need to emphasise to people to act responsibly when deciding to buy or take a dog into their lives and to be responsible owners, and the bill will help to do that. The low welfare puppy trade is unacceptable and an area that the Scottish Government has been concerned about for many years. We have worked closely with stakeholders such as the SPCA and Dogs Trust to improve enforcement and understanding of the welfare problems and the risks to buyers associated with criminal activity behind this trade. And this has included marketing campaigns which were effective at raising awareness of the importance of seeing puppies with their mother before buying, and many more. We know that the movement restrictions during the COVID pandemic meant that it's not possible for significant periods of time, and there was an increased demand for puppies to be kept as family pets, as we know. It's therefore appropriate to consider again what more can be done to influence changes in behaviour of buyers so that they make the right choices when sourcing a pet. We look forward to hearing stakeholders' views as well as those of the committee, and will consider carefully your Stage 1 report. We do have some issues with the framing of some parts of the bill, which we consider might benefit from amendment. We're very happy to discuss them with you and Ms Graham during the bill process. But I would hope that we're able to reach an agreement on those and other matters so we can arrive at a bill at Stage 3 that everyone can support and will have a tangible impact on dog welfare. Thanks, Convener.
Thank you. Now, I'll kick off with the questions. So we know that the government agrees with the general principles of legislation and its attempt to increase public awareness. Surely that's something that can be done without a bill. It says basically that the only difference or the new powers in the bill that are created are in sections 2 to 4 of certain items that need to be included in the code. So do you really believe there is a gap in what's already in place and what this new legislation might put? Is it not a sledgehammer to crack a nut?
Well, I guess that's really for the committee to decide whether that's the case, and your question to Ms Graham. But from our perspective, I mean, I'll go back to what I said in my opening statement, is that there has been a real increase in the practices of those selling puppies who don't have their welfare at heart. And it's becoming increasingly more difficult for, you know, people who want to source a puppy to know that they're getting a puppy that has been bred well and that they're not, perpetuating some kind of trade which does not have animal welfare at heart. We've all heard the terrible stories. We've seen the documentaries about the illegal puppy trafficking trade and some of the ways in which they try to dupe families into taking their pups. And we've seen all the heartbreaking stories. So in my view, and I guess why we're supporting of the general principles, is that anything which has an improved code of practice, which is bringing up to date some of the issues that I've just mentioned and some of the advice that can be given to people, and a campaign centred on that would be very, very helpful. Now, is it a sledgehammer to crack a nut? I have to say there are some, as I alluded to in my opening statement, there are some areas in which we do think that there's parts that they do need amending, and we can come on to them later. Whether or not it requires a bill or not, I guess, is for the person putting forward the bill to actually say that is the case. But we are supporting Christine Graham with the general aims of the bill. I want to address your question about gaps. I mean, I do think that there are gaps that a new code of practice could usefully fit, like the awareness of some of the health issues with particular breeds. There are breeds of dogs that go into fashion, as we all know, and some of these have congenital issues that mean that their life is shortened or they have health issues throughout their whole lives. And I think that one of the things that we need to have an awareness is some of the dogs, French bulldogs come to mind, that have issues with breathing. There's other dogs that are prone to heart conditions. There's other dogs that are prone to joint conditions as well. I think there has to be an awareness of the potential costs to a buyer of the maintenance of breeds that would have health issues as well. And I think that's one of the gaps that could be filled as well. A focus on that buyer's knowledge and the highlighting the best practice and how to source a puppy that's going to live a long, happy life, I think is something that is a gap that could be filled.
Yeah, I'm still think it's a bit bizarre. We all, I think everybody in the general public, not just this committee, would welcome anything that increased the public awareness of the rights and wrongs around buying a puppy. But from what you say, it sounds like the only areas where there might be gaps is a lacking in the current code of practice. But you actually have legislation in place which already gives you powers to change that code of practice. And the majority of all the other items in the bill doesn't force the government to do anything. And apart from registration, which you're against, so I'm still worried that we're about to put through a bill where the concerns you've raised, actually, you do have the powers right now to address without additional piece of legislation.
That's a fair point. We could amend. Of course, we could amend the existing code of practice, and that wouldn't require any legislation. I've heard expressed by animal welfare organisations in front of your committee and out with that they wouldn't want two codes of practice. And I can see their point, and I have some sympathy with that. At the same time, Ms Graham's bill could give an additional spotlight to those issues as well, and that's something that those organisations have also said. Those advice for those adopting or buying dogs would be helpful in getting those messages across to the public. Having particular focus on that in a parliamentary bill would provide that spotlight. Dog purchasers been able to buy with their confidence. And also, one thing that I haven't mentioned as well is about the issues around adopting dogs from other countries as well, and some of the good guidance around that as well is something that maybe isn't in a code of practice currently. So I guess it's up to the committee to decide whether or not that legislation is required or not. But my view is that a bill could put that spotlight on it.
Yeah, I question whether Parliament's time in putting forward or dealing with a bill and putting legislation is the best way to highlight or spotlight things, where there's other ways to do that. I don't think that's the reason for having bills. However, I'll now move on to questions from Alistair Allen.
Thank you, Convener. You've identified, and the Convener's identified, I think probably some of the need for education more generally around buying and selling a dog. Can I ask what does the Scottish Government do at present to promote that education? And how do you see those activities relating to this code of practice proposed in this bill?
Yeah, I can go through some of the things that we're already doing. So for some time, obviously, we've had campaigns and we've been working with other agencies on campaigns around it, particularly the one where we highlighted the need for prospective buyers to see pups with their mother as well. I think sort of where's the mum? I think was the sort of like the tagline on that. But there's other work that the Scottish Government are doing in partnership with, you know, the UK government, with border agencies. I'll run through some of those things. We have been part of a puppy trade working group. Led by the SPCA, that's encouraged the sharing of intelligence between enforcement agencies across the UK about illegal breeding, import and trade of puppies. We have HMRC as part of that group as well, and we have been able to reclaim significant amounts of tax from undeclared income from puppy breeders and dealers, and that has also been able to identify some of the people. This is a very lucrative business. I mean, an organised crime is involved in it. It is the sort of people that are involved in other lucrative criminal enterprise as well. But, of course, the product here is puppies. A lot of those puppies, as we know, I've heard heartbreaking stories about the fact that they don't live very long and families are absolutely devastated and there's no recourse at all. We don't know where those puppies come from. We, you know, the buyers wouldn't even know where those puppies were even bred. So all of that, in conjunction with SPCA, campaigns that we have been involved in jointly, members will know a lot of those campaigns come to the Parliament every year. We have particular campaigns around Christmas time to, you know, to just to highlight the fact that maybe, you know, that whole idea of buying a puppy at Christmas is not the best idea. And I suppose shining a light also on the adopt, don't shop aspect of things as well, which we work with the SPCA, because as we've seen during COVID, there's a lot of people actually took on puppies, and once the sort of lockdown times were over, realised that their lifestyle wasn't, well, the lifestyle that they went back to after COVID wasn't in line with caring for a dog. And the shelters at the moment are absolutely chock full of dogs needing homes, never mind anything else. And I think that's the kind of places that we've concentrated on. But as I said, Christine Graham's bill wants to shine a light on some of the other areas of advice and campaigning that could reasonably help people make informed choices about buying a puppy.
Thank you, Minister.
Anne Burgess.
Thanks and good morning. Just kind of following on from Alistair Allen's question. So the charity Blue Cross states that a separate code of practice for those about to buy a dog rather than on ownership itself would complement the existing code of practice, as they cover two different areas of dog ownership, namely acquiring a dog and owning a dog. And I'd be interested to know is the Scottish Government supportive of producing guidance on responsibly acquiring, buying and selling a dog?
Yeah, we absolutely are. And I think I've alluded to certain areas where I think there could usefully be more updated advice. I think particularly on the health issues associated with some breeds as well. And that's something that the Kennel Club have been lobbying both UK and Scottish governments about, highlighting some of the health issues that are associated with dogs that are particularly fashionable at the time. And are on Instagram, and, you know, influencers have them, etc. And, you know, we may smile, but these, you know, they are influencers for a reason. And people may rush into buying a dog and then find out a year down the line that dog is seriously ill or has issues that they're having to pay an absolute fortune for month on month for medication to keep them healthy. And they've not factored that in to their you know, their household income or etc. One of the things about the code of practice as outlined in Ms Graham's bill is, though, that I think, and I did say in my opening statement, there were some areas which we would like to see amended. It's quite prescriptive at the moment. And I believe that when you have a code of practice for anything associated with legislation, that should be done by consultation once the bill is passed. I think because you might be getting views on what should be in that code of practice from a large range of stakeholders. So what I wouldn't want to do is have a prescriptive code of practice in the bill that ties us in primary legislation to having a definitive code of practice when there might be other areas that could usefully go into that, that code of practice.
Thanks for that. You mentioned the Kennel Club, and we've got in our papers the kind of 2021, 22, 23 surveys, and just, you know, the situation is bad, and it just seems to get, you know, seems to stay the same. I'd be interested to know a couple of things. One, given the rising problem of puppies, or the continuing problem, why haven't ministers brought forward a code using the powers under the 2006 Act already? So that's one part. And then the other piece is around the amendments. I would actually, I mean, I understand the general practice of trying not to put things into legislation because there's the need for flexibility or consultation, but I would imagine that Christine Graham had consulted on the elements that needed to be in there. And it seems to me that in this case, if there weren't going to be the kind of specifics that she's asking for to be in the bill, then what makes this special and why, you know, again, comes back to my, it's kind of connected to my initial part of the question, which is why haven't ministers brought forward something already?
Gosh, well, I'm not entirely sure if I can answer why ministers haven't. Obviously, I've had this responsibility for animal welfare since June, and obviously Ms Graham's bill was well underway by that point. And there are a lot of members that raise issues around dog ownership. I know there's other bills and there's petitions come in, etc. I think we have really been we've really just been concentrating on the campaigns that I've mentioned, you know, off the back of our partnership work with organisations. We help promote campaigns, we help fund campaigns, we have this sort of like rolling kind of like work that we do highlighting the issues around dog ownership, which we think have been reasonably successful in raising public awareness. So, but again, revising the code of practice, no, it has not been done. And it's that, I mean, it's been there since, I think, 2009. I think it's off the back of a 2006 piece of legislation, but it hasn't actually been, wasn't enacted in 2009. It is, yeah, I agree, it's time for the refresh, and it's possible if Ms Graham hadn't brought forward this bill that we might have been looking at doing that.
Thanks.
Walton.
Well, I'm going to do this question to death because it's already been done twice from my colleagues, but the stakeholders, Ms Martin said that the 2006 code does need updated and it does need revised, and that was the feedback that we got. They also suggested that the solution, well, this was the Scottish Animal Welfare Commission, said that the solution is for Scottish ministers to introduce a revised code under the combined authority of the 2006 Act. So there were some considerable evidence, it was considerable evidence that Scottish ministers should consider this. And I think one of the areas that we talked about was considering those mechanisms are already in place. I mean, what are your views in general? Because obviously this committee needs to come to a conclusion on Ms Graham's bill. What are your views on using those mechanisms and expanding on some of the questions that have already been asked and reflecting on the evidence that people have given?
Yeah, I'm not sure what I can usefully add. I mean, I appreciate Ms Hamilton wants to hammer home this, other things that have been mentioned. I'm not entirely sure what I can usefully add that I haven't said already around this. It is right to say the code of practice does exist. The powers to amend that code of practice does exist as relates to the 2006 Act. I mean, one thing's about members' bills, and I know a few people around this table have done members' bills in the past, and I'm certainly was one of them when I was at a backbencher, is it can raise awareness for issues, and it can have a campaign associated with it, and it can, you know, again, shine a light on some of the issues that a member feels is lacking, or society at large feels is lacking in terms of awareness. And I applaud members that do that, and this is one such case.
That, you know, we do consider and come to the recommendation that that we believe that the code, the 2006 Code of Practice, could be revised or updated. I mean, what process, what happens after? Do the Scottish ministers just respond in a more detailed fashion? Because at the moment, I don't feel that the committee are able to make a decision on understanding why we do need another code of practice. Because also, the 2006 code provides a high level of parliamentary scrutiny. Because if it was revised, it would have to come back to the parliament for consideration. But Ms Graham's wouldn't. Can you enlighten us, or even possibly commit to writing to us as to what might be the consideration at the stage where there was an either-or recommendation from this committee to revise that 2006 code?
I would respond to any recommendation that the committee makes to me. I mean, I think that's a sort of general, you know, professional response. I mean, anything in which the committee makes a recommendation, whether it takes the form of a letter, whether it takes the form of a stage one report, any communication from the convener with a recommendation would get a response from me.
I'm not trying to be cheeky. What I am trying to do is trying to establish in my own mind how we understand this and the process of it, and I suppose it is ultimately up to yourself whether you decide whether the Code of Practice in the 2006 Act could be revised or updated or amended to reflect a sort of a new content that some of the stakeholders are asking for.
Well, what's in front of us right now is Ms Graham's bill, which intends to have a new Code of Practice. And I guess it's up to the committee to decide whether or not they get behind Ms Graham's ideas in having a new Code of Practice with the things that is outlined in her draft bill, or maybe amendments to what's outlined in her draft bill, or whether you decide or not to take a different view on the revision of an existing Code of Practice. And that is in the committee's gift to make that recommendation.
But just to be clear, Convener, you, as the Minister in charge of this, believe that the 2006... content could be updated, amended or revised?
It's not a belief, it's a statement of fact. It could be. Yeah.
Yeah, and it needs to be.
I think there are a number of areas in dog welfare and the sale of puppies to the public that could be doing with being in a Code of Practice. Yes, absolutely.
OK, thank you.
So just to be clear, given your concerns around the gaps in the Code of Practice, you've clearly stated in response to Alistair Allen and Rachel Hamilton there, does that give us a commitment that if the committee decides not to recommend that the Christine Graham's bill goes forward, or Parliament doesn't vote at stage one, is that a commitment to address the gaps that you've quite clearly laid out in the current Code of Practice?
To be honest, Convener, if I can use the words of Ms Hamilton, be a bit cheeky. What's in front of us is Ms Graham's bill. Ms Graham is present in the room wanting to see her bill go forward. And effectively, what you're asking me is to say, will we do everything that Ms Graham is wanting to do in her bill anyway without the need for this bill? And I don't think that's a particularly fair question. It might be a fair question for you to deliberate in private, but what you're asking me to do... So we've set out our support of the general principles of the state, but we've also, and I will continue during the session today, if asked, outline areas where we think the bill could usefully be amended.
Yeah, I have the utmost respect for any member who brings forward a member's bill, absolutely, and I take my hat off to Christine Graham and her attempts, successful and otherwise, on bills that she's brought forward over her time in this place. However, we've also, as a committee, got to recognise resource capacity and the ability for the committee and prioritisation. And given that your statement and the government's view on this bill is that you actually have the powers already to address almost everything that Ms Graham's bill is going to do, I just get the feeling you see this as a public awareness exercise that you can already do under the existing powers. So that's where our concern comes for. This
I
is
can
not
see
about
that. I can see
disrespecting
that.
Ms Graham's bill.
Mm-hmm. Asking me to commit to something out with the confines of this bill, I'd rather concentrate on a review on the bill as laid and the potential amendments that we might want to see.
But I still think the question stands. If the bill wasn't to progress, given your comments about the concerns and the gaps in the existing code of practice, will you commit to addressing those gaps through the powers that you already have?
Well, I'll commit to improving dog welfare wherever I can.
OK, thank you. Another question from Alistair Allen.
Thank you, Convener. what view would you take, and you've kind of hinted at this, but what view would you take on the fact that the bill sets out a code of conduct, section 2-4 of the bill, on the face of the bill? What would it actually involve if at some future stage, if we were dealing with new breeds of dogs, new problems, what would it actually involve to amend that as it stands?
Yeah, and you, Dr. Allen, you have hit upon, I think, my issue with the prescription of what should be in that code of practice, and that's where I think we would like to see amendments made to that. Because if you are too prescriptive about what is in a code of practice in the face of a bill, as you know, then you need secondary legislation to amend it as things change and go forward. And I think I've said in my responses to other members as well, things do change. Trends change in dog ownership, different breeding standards change, different types of dogs come on the market with different issues, and we see that all the time. The people that are involved in the less than professional aspect of puppy breeding are clever and are able to do things to avoid detection. They are fleet of foot in any kind of aspect of duping the public into thinking that they are responsible breeders. And as such, revisions of codes, notwithstanding the fact that we have not revised the 2009 one, and that's an issue for us to discuss, but having a prescriptive code of practice identified in the face of the bill will make it harder to change, because it would have to go through Parliament as secondary legislation.
And finally, on that point, more generally, I mean, this is a pressure which I'm sure all ministers come under, particularly at stage 3 of legislation and so on, to put all sorts of things on the face of the bill, and that phrase is thrown around. But is what you're saying, that putting everything on the face of the bill with regards to the code of conduct would not be helpful in the government's view?
I don't think it'd be helpful. I don't believe in general it's helpful to do that, because it means that there's not the flexibility to adapt to a change in circumstance of any type.
OK, thank you.
Thank you.
Kate Forbes.
Thanks very much, and good morning. You mentioned in your opening statement that the government had identified some areas where it might seek to amend the bill, and your memorandum, I believe, specifies that. And I wondered if we could unpack that a little bit more in terms of specific amendments that the government would work with Christine Graham on in terms of tweaks to Part 1 in particular.
OK, so I'm probably going to repeat myself here, because really the issues with Part 1 is around the wording of any code of practice. At the moment, I feel some of the wording makes it look directory rather than advisory. And I don't think it would require too much to make that clearer. And I think that actually, I mean, without putting words into Ms Graham's mouth, I think the intention behind Ms Graham's bill in Part 1 is for it to be advisory rather than directory. She has stated, I think, in her policy memorandum, she wants to achieve behavioural change without placing formal obligations on the parties involved. That's the quote that I've got in front of me. So I think there's some amendments in the wording that's required to make that clear. I've already mentioned to other members about the prescriptive content in the Code of Practice being in the face of the bill. I never feel that's particularly helpful. And I think that, you know, Convener mentioned about parliamentary time, that when things are in the face of the bill and circumstances change, that takes up parliamentary time. And I think that we really need to sort of, you know, have on the face of the bill something that doesn't wouldn't require adaptation necessarily, but would have that flexibility built in a code of practice for X, but that code of practice could be something that could be added to and changed to over time.
So I suppose, just in summary, those are relatively minor.
There's another aspect, I think, is about the code of practice being ready within 6 months of royal assent. And given what I've said about the code of practice not being prescriptive in the wording of the bill, I think the most useful course of action when a bill's passed that requires a code of practice is it goes out for consultation again once the legislation is passed. I don't believe that 6 months is enough time for that to be achieved. And if it is to be the sort of bill and have the sort of impact that Ms Graham wants, and Ms Graham is somebody who cares very much for the welfare of animals, we all know that, is that the best thing to do is to have a consultation that means that this code of practice can be the best that it can be. And so we require more than 6 months to do that.
Thanks very much.
Thank you. Minister, what's your understanding of the definition of a pet?
Pet, an animal that you have in your domestic house that you actually ask to be there, you know, and that you have as a family, an extended family member, I suppose, would be.
Okay, so what's your views on this bill only covering pets and not other dogs potentially?
So is the convener asking what my view is on it not being applicable to working dogs that you would have living out with the home and that you, the person would not class as pets?
Or greyhounds, and some definition of how some people would view greyhounds.
Yeah, I mean, that's actually something that maybe should be explored. I mean, my impression was that it really is about the purchasing of all puppies. You're purchasing puppies regardless of whether or not they're going to be a pet or whether they're necessarily going to be in your home. My understanding is that Ms Graham's bill is about the decisions around the purchasing of a puppy or a dog in general.
Well, it currently excludes working dogs.
Right, okay.
Is that something you agree with, or should working dogs be included in this?
Do you know what? I think I need to give that some more thought, because that's something that I haven't really appreciated.
Okay, thanks. Jim Fairley.
Thanks, Kimura. Good morning, Minister. We've had various engagement sessions with stakeholders, and they've suggested that public awareness of the existing code of practice is low. So how would the Scottish Government intend to effectively raise awareness of any new guidance required under the bill?
So yeah, I've heard that evidence that the awareness of the code of practice is low. I imagine that awareness of quite a lot of code of practices that have been as a result of legislation by the general public is low. You have to go into a government website. It's what happens off the back of that code of practice, the campaigns that happen off the back of those code of practices that I've alluded to. So whilst you might not have a lot of people, you know, logging on to look at the 2009 code as drafted code of practice, you will have the awareness that has emanated from from that as a result of the sort of public campaigns that I've mentioned already, Scottish Government working with SSPCA, the Where's the Mum campaign, the yearly campaigns that we all are very aware of around about Christmas time, around buying a puppy, the Adopt Don't Shop campaigns as well. So they sort of like emanate from that code of practice. So I think in a way, yeah, okay, I understand people's awareness of that code of practice as it is written, and the letter of it is probably not high, because let's face it, we're talking about the general public who don't spend their time on government websites. But there is an awareness out there, very much so, about seeing puppies with their mother, looking to adopt adult dogs rather than a puppy, what you need to consider ahead of taking a dog into your home and to fit in with your lifestyle. There's more awareness coming out from, as I say, about the sort of health conditions associated with dogs as well. So that is happening in a more general sense as a part of campaigning that probably stemmed from that code of practice.
I have to say, the only campaign that I can actually remember, A Dog Is For Life, Not Just For Christmas. It's the only one that sticks with me.
That just goes to show you how effective that was then.
It shows you how old I am as well.
Mm-hmm, I wasn't going to say that.
But the financial memorandum gives an initial public raising awareness campaign fund of between 200,000 and 250,000. What's your view on that figure for the purpose of raising the campaign?
Yeah, the financial memorandum associated with the campaigns, I don't have any concerns about. I think that it's realistic and in line with similar campaigns.
Okay, thanks, Kevin.
Just on that, can you tell us what the budget is for animal welfare regarding dogs from the Scottish Government at the moment?
I don't have that information. I don't know whether any of my officials have. We can certainly write back to you. I don't have that in front of me.
Yeah, that would certainly help, because the recurring theme is public awareness. And you've mentioned...
It's a reasonable question, but I don't have that information.
Yeah. And you've mentioned Where's the Mum, Not Just for Christmas, so on. So it would be quite good to find out exactly what the government's contribution to those public awareness schemes was, so that if you could get back to us on that would be helpful. Rachel Hamilton.
Supplementary on Jim Fairley's question, that from what you were saying about the public awareness, it must raise concerns in your mind about the code of conduct of the 2006 Act in terms of the public awareness of that and how effective that is, and then creating another code on top of that, will that just have the same outcome? Failure to comply with the code is not offence in itself, and therefore where is the... the carrot here. Is this code just another duplication that is for show?
I think the carrot, as you put it, is families and people who are buying dogs having good advice and knowing that when they buy a puppy from somewhere that they've followed the best practice and that they can have comfort that they have not perpetrated any kind of nefarious trade, or they're not buying a potentially ill puppy that is devastating when that puppy becomes ill. So that is the carrot there. The carrot, I suppose, as well, from Miss Graham's point of view, again, I don't want to put words in her mouth, is that people who are selling puppies, who conform to that code, have almost a kind of a sort of quality assurance associated with what they're doing.
Just on the back of Finlay's question there, the convener's question, about the cost, how much intervention do the Scottish ministers have on understanding, or is it provided by Ms Graham? I can't ask her directly, but the actual cost of the staffing for the public awareness campaign.
So, again, that is really a question for Ms Graham. She has come up with those figures, but we have looked at those figures and they seem in line with other types of campaigns of that sort. So I imagine that the 200,000 or the 250,000, I forget the exact figure, takes into, I mean, a campaign pretty much is the staffing associated with the materials that go out there, particularly now when you're talking about materials that are probably digital. It is a staffing and a creative cost.
Okay, thank you.
Ariane Burgess.
Thanks, Convener. I just wanted to come back on the kind of area of questions around the kind of prescriptive nature of the code. So what Christine Graham has put is section 2-4, and that all seems to me to be barely generic in a way, or I can't imagine that there'd be a problem with those, because you would want to ask those questions or have that kind of situation. Maybe the certificate might be something, section 4, that might be something that would want to change. But it seems to me that what she's laid out here is sections 2-4 would be required, but section 5 provides ministers that they may revise the code from time to time so long as it continues to give effect to the sections 2-4. So she wants to ensure that those ones always have a lasting life. And they do seem to me just fairly, generic or fundamental kinds of things you would want in a code. So I wonder, I hear you saying that they're a bit prescriptive, but you also pointed to the six-month period and the desire to go out to consultation again. So I would be interested to hear if the change of the months, 6 months, to a longer time, and maybe you could indicate what that would be, whether we'd be open to that amendment.
Yeah, and I think certainly open to an amendment which could effectively double that time. I'll come back to some of the other thing that I think it said in response to Ms. Forbes about we would support amendments that clarify that provisions of section 2-4 would form part of the code of practice are advisory in nature rather than directory. Okay, I think where our issues really do lie.
Language thing there then. Yeah. Okay, all right, that's really helpful. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Can I bring in Christine Graham now for questions?
Thank you very much, Convener, and I promise I won't give evidence, which is terribly tempting. I shall have my day. Can I just challenge the Minister on one or two things? Well, you knew I would do it. You say the existing codes are functioning. How come then that so many people are still buying online? Puppy factory farms are still very successful if the codes of practice are effective?
Well, because of everything that I have said about the practices of the people that are perpetrating these less than optimum circumstances for puppy breeding, these are very clever people. And Miss Graham, I do worry that some aspects of the bill fully great intentions about what they might achieve. I don't necessarily think that a code of practice is the only tool in the box that is going to deal with that trade. I have mentioned some of the work that's been done between the Scottish Government and other agencies as part of the group that's been set up, working with HMRC, working with Border Force, working with other administrations on the particular organisations that are involved in the practices I don't think a code of practice is ever going to solve that. However, what I do agree with you on your bill is that we need a new set of guidance that enhances and improves the awareness that people have about some of the practices that are happening now, some of the things that should be taken into account when they are looking to buy or adopt a dog or a puppy. And anything in that regard is going to be helpful. Is it going to solve the terrible situation that we see, particularly puppies coming in from Eastern Europe and Ireland, which are effectively farmed in massive sheds, like some kind of conveyor belt type factory? That's something that's going to require working between administrations, working with border forces, and as I say, working with HMRC in actually identifying these individuals that are making money from puppies and are involved in organised crime. That's a lot bigger than what you're proposing in your bill.
May I? Would you accept that my intention in this bill is to try to tackle the very supply that you've named by educating demand? That's what, would you accept that that's what this bill is about? That when you look at things like Section 2, that if we can educate people, then by doing that, we will at least have a better go at preventing the misery that some puppies go through than trying to do it when we get at the other end of it and try to catch them.
That's why I'm supportive, very supportive of part one of the bill, because that is about the education.
Yeah, move on to the fact that there's an existing code of practice. Would you accept, apart from the fact that I would dispute that people pay much attention to it, but that it doesn't deal, as my code of practice does, specifically with considering all the issues I raise in here prior to acquiring a dog, not once you've got it, before you even get there, so that you might not get one at all.
Yeah. And that is the reason why I'm supportive of the general principles of your bill, because that is absolutely what is required, is about the advice and enhanced advice that could be given to people well ahead of having a puppy or a dog in their homes.
Would you accept that to put something, courts of practice are not primary legislation, but by putting this in primary legislation, you can embed in the public conscience that this is, to put it in common parlance, the law, whereas they don't see courts of practice as the law. Would you accept that?
I think we need to have a discussion about the wording of what's around the bill and the code of practice to address some of the concerns about advisory and directory. I get the wider point, and I think I probably said something fairly similar to what you've just said, is that by having something in a bill like this, it does have that, I suppose, that heft behind it.
Just two more. I've just got two more, and I'm trying to be very, very pointed about them. Minister, you referred to, I think it's Section 2, and Section 2, subsection, yes, Section 2, subsection 2, as being prescriptive. And if I can refer to Section 2, subsection 2A, because you went on about different breeds of dog, and I understand all about the breeds and how difficult it is when they're bred in certain ways. I don't think that's prescriptive. If I read it, it says, is the breed of dog suitable for you? That's very broad. That takes into account any changes in breeding that takes place along the line. So that if we have breeds that come along that, again, are, to use a term perhaps that's controversial, quotes, deformed, close quotes, have difficulties in breeding or walking or whatever because it's fashionable, that is contained in there. Is that breed of dog suitable for you? Because it also goes on to say, recognise that some breeds require more space, exercise and care than others. And what I would ask you is, does that encapsulate your concerns that people should consider, which you raised about, I can never say the word, about the bulldog breeds and the Staffordshire with difficulty in breathing, that they have to consider all that before they take on that breed? You see, I think that's very, very broad. I think that builds in for the future, but I'm just contesting your evidence.
I believe that there are tweaks that are required to that part of the bill that would give real flexibility in the code of practice for unforeseen developments in this area. And I'm not entirely sure why Miss Graham wouldn't want that.
Well, just very briefly, because this is my only chance. Regarding, nobody's mentioned the certificate, which is Section 4, the little certificate that's put in. And Would the minister accept that by putting this simple thing in, it's a confirmation that both the person transferring the animal and the person acquiring it have read and understood their commitments that lie ahead?
Helpful, and I think that would actually focus the minds, and it's almost a psychological thing. If you've actually signed something, you've got a certificate that you've actually had to think through some of the aspects of that. I think that is something that would prompt prompt reflection, and I actually I'm in agreement with that. I think people should be doing that already. People should be doing that very much already. It's a commitment of up to about 15 years that people are making. It is a living being that they're having in their house that requires expense and attention and makes a massive difference to your everyday life. And I think it's almost acts as a checklist. I agree with that.
My final question, convener, thank you for your tolerance, is, has the minister seen my response to the Delegated Powers Committee regarding the code of practice and any revisions to it?
I probably have that in all the briefings that I went through in the last couple of days, Ms Graham. Am I going
to
get tested on it?
The minister, but can I advise you that I have agreed with the DPLR that it can come for parliamentary scrutiny? They wanted it to come, the code of practice, if this goes through, plus anything else, to go before parliamentary scrutiny. So just to clarify, I appreciate that the minister... I don't know if the committee has seen that piece. Well, it's a shame you've not got it either, because that has already been resolved. I've no further questions. I've lots more, but I'm taking up a lot of time.
Thank you, Ms Graham. I understand that DPLR haven't reported yet, so we've yet to see that. Just before moving on from the code of conduct... Code of practice, beg your pardon. We talked about the bill as a method of raising awareness. Well, we could say this bill has been a means to an end, and it's resulted in this committee considering something that we probably wouldn't have scheduled otherwise. So it's already achieved something. But what it does highlight is that there's a code of practice there. I think, as a minister, as a committee, we've held you to account over that there's gaps in the code of conduct or code of practice. Given that the welfare of dogs is your responsibility, why don't you just get out there and change the code of conduct, and then we can all go home happy that the ultimate aim of Christine's bill has been achieved?
That could be your recommendation. I mean, if the committee obviously will have to discuss how they view Ms Graham's bill and put all those questions to Ms Graham when she comes before you. You will be reporting on stage one. We'll be having a debate in stage one. And that could be the committee's view.
But that could be one of the solutions.
You know how these things work, Mr. Carson. You've been doing it long enough.
Thank you. We're going to now move on to register of unlicensed litters, and I've got a question from Beatrice Wishart.
Thanks, convener, and good morning. Given that organisations like the Dogs Trust and the Battersea Cats and Dogs Home agree with the idea of registering litters from breeders below the current licensing threshold, I wonder, Minister, if you could explain why the Scottish Government disagrees with the need for this.
So, there's a couple of things. In 2021, we made changes to that. I actually have to give credit to Christine Graham for prompting that. I think initially Ms Graham was looking at doing work around the welfare of dogs. There was, changes proposed about three and up per year litters being classed as being needing to be licensed and registered, and I think that was a really good move. And I think that really has made a difference in the whole regime around this. My issues with having and they will be families and individuals whose, usually their pet dog would have, a litter, one litter or another, maybe another dog would have a second litter, whatever. That necessarily, to me, isn't a breeding business. That's a family where their dog has had a litter. And I don't think they can be classed the same as people that are businesses. Local authorities, I think my main issue here is that local authorities already have responsibility for licensed breeders, that's the breeding of three litters and above. To add a register for unlicensed breeders, I think would add too much of a burden, and I'm not convinced really what it would achieve in terms of animal welfare. There's also responsible individuals in this situation where they've got a litter will apply. The irresponsible ones won't. And how do local authorities enforce that? What would be the personnel power in having that? And an unquantifiable at the moment amount of people. How would they be identified? How could they be quantified? I mean, we're talking about, again, probably a domestic situation. And all of a sudden, people may maybe find, and I think Karen Adam made a very good point, if I may, in one of the sessions. Mistakes happen. Not to put too fine a point of it, and all of a sudden you find that your unneutered female dog is having puppies at 4 a.m. in your kitchen. And all of a sudden, you know, you might not have the wherewithal or the time to, you know, all of a sudden you've got to be licensed as some kind of dog breeder on a. I think it's onerous, and I think it's probably unmanageable from a local authority point of view at a time where local authorities are stretched and are finding it difficult to deal with the, you know, providing the services that they already provide. So that. And the policy memorandum, to be fair to Ms Graham, recognised the enforcement burden that is on local authorities. But there's also, again, the cost of establishing and maintaining a register. There's the personnel associated with enforcing it. I just don't see how it's workable. And that is my reason for my support of the general principles of the bill, particularly being around the education of the buyer, etc. But the registration of the unlicensed breeders, I'm not convinced that it's needed and that it will have an effect and that it's workable.
My second question was about the local authority resources, but I think you've answered that, so I'll leave it there.
Alistair Allen, did you have a supplementary?
Thank you, Convener. Yeah, I appreciate we're asking you lots of questions about a bill which is not your bill, but I'd be keen to have your view on the efficacy of the registration scheme in terms of what you feel would be the costs associated with maintaining it and who would do the updating of the register.
So the updating of the register and everything to do with the register would fall to the local authority is my understanding, and I think we've got estimates here of about the setting up. The setup would be estimated about £20,000. Now, presumably, that's for every local authority to set up a database, and the maintenance of that being about £16,000 a year. But I see that as only been part of the cost, because there's the enforcement aspect of people actually registering as well. There's another issue with that, though, and I worry that being on a register would almost act as a false kind of like kite mark for the puppies that you are, you know, if I'm on this register. It doesn't really have much in the way of responsibilities associated with it. It doesn't have any of the kind of like conditions that the licensed breeders have around inspection and animal welfare concerns. And going back to our concerns about the types of people and individuals and organisations that are involved in puppy trafficking, I do worry that a register that has families that have the dog, that have the... They might, if there's a public register, they might be targeted by those people as being a front for potentially their operations as well. We've seen that before in the kind of like puppies brought in from outside Scotland or outside the UK and given to Airbnbs are rented, and there's a bitch there that is not the mother of the puppies. People come thinking it's a family home. It's not. I think that there is potentially, it's just a niggle that I have about this register acting as almost a kind of like a potential kite mark type front that would add some kind of legitimacy to something that otherwise is not legitimate. That's just a little worry I have about this.
Thank you, Minister.
Thank you. Question from Karen Adam.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Minister. I have a question. I suppose it's in two parts, and you've maybe touched upon this already, actually. But it's, does the Scottish Government agree that there is a need for greater traceability overseeing the selling of puppies, generally?
So there's a couple of things I would say, but I think there's... Given the issues that we've described about the illegal puppy trafficking trade and everything, I think that there's a number of things that have been done, both UK-wide and in Scotland, around the traceability of puppies. You have to, by law, your dog has to be microchipped, right? So and that's the owner's responsibility to have that. There is the possibility that the database for microchipping could be adapted to have more than just the information of the owner and the address of the owner. Because I think initially it was about tracing lost pets, really. Mm-hmm. Now it's about more traceability, etc. Could it have the breeder's information? What would that add necessarily? Again, these organisations can be very clever at circumventing those kind of things. So I would say that there's already multiple databases out there that dogs should have microchipped, and there's a good awareness of that. Of course, when it comes to pedigree dogs, there's additional... I suppose, administration around them in terms of kennel club certificates. Mm-hmm. So anybody that's bought a pedigree dog or is responding to any kind of like advert with a pedigree dog would be very silly indeed if they bought a dog without seeing kennel club registration. I mean, and I think there's a decent public awareness about that. Mm-hmm. But particularly, you're probably spending upwards of £1,000. You're not going to take. You would be very silly if you came away with a puppy that was, say, a King Charles Spaniel, and then you didn't have the documentation associated with that to tell you that who its parents were, its grandparents are. You know the kind of registration we've had. Yeah. So that's already a traceability element. Of course, that's not all dogs. Not all dogs are kennel club registered, and people will buy dogs that are not. KC registered as well, but dog breeding itself is licensed under the licensing of the animal welfare license of activities involving animals regulations 2021, and I've mentioned about the 3+ litters means that you're effectively a breeding business, that you have to register, you have to be licensed. I think there's quite a lot of information there. The UK government had, in fact, can I just bring this up because I don't want to get it wrong. The UK government did have, it was the proposed UK Kept Animals Bill, and the Scottish Parliament actually gave consent to legislative consent in January 2022. and that was about the age limit of imported puppies. So I think it was proposing that you couldn't import puppies below a certain age. So that would have added to the traceability. Unfortunately, it was dropped. But I believe that there is it could come back as a private members bill next year. So that kind of legislation, and I would welcome that, and I would hope that the Parliament would give that legislative consent again, because that's another tool in the box, because part of the problem that Ms Graham's bill is trying to address is this the importing of puppies from parts of the world that don't have the strict regulations that we have in this country. So I think that would be a very welcome step, certainly in the traceability as well.
That's really helpful, because secondly, I was going to ask if there was anything in this bill that you feel would tackle the issues regarding traceability and, you know, oversight of the puppy trade, essentially. And if not, is there things there already in the toolbox?
But there's a number of things. Is this bill going to solve the problem, I think, that we're all wrestling with? Mm. No. Would it increase public awareness of some of the good practice and actually making sure that you come away with a healthy puppy and that you are ready for dog ownership and that you're a responsible dog owner and you're making a responsible choice? Yes, I think so.
It's helpful. Thank you.
Thank you. Alistair Allen.
Thank you, Convener. What's the government's understanding of how the register would be publicly accessed, and does that take us into the realms of data protection law? So how would people view that data?
Yes, if you give me a minute, because I think that's something that is, you've alluded to data protection and whether it would be public and what would be available for anybody to look at publicly on that register. And I guess it's your question, I mean, you'll have the opportunity to put that to Ms Graham about how she sees that register functioning. But there will be certain things about, you know, what is there for the public, a person who wants to buy a puppy from somebody, what is there on that register for them to look at that is going to make them think, this is a responsible purchase that I'm making, this is a puppy that I know is going to have its welfare been looked after, this is a puppy that I can trust is not come from it. Probably relatively little, because you know, what has actually been asked to be on this register, probably names and addresses. But even in that, names and addresses come back to my little niggle that I had about publicly available information of people who could even only just have had one, their dogs just had one litter, or been on a public register. I do worry that they could be targeted by people that want to offer them money to act as a front for their activities as well. That's the thing that I worried about me most.
Thank you.
So just follow on. So if the information wasn't publicly available, you were concerned about that, how would it work?
That's a good question. I mean, in part two of the bill, I'll be honest with you, we are not sold on part two of the bill. So what would a register of these unlicensed individuals whose pet dogs have had a litter of puppies, what would it do for animal welfare? I'm not convinced.
So it's an effect, you don't see how a register could work?
I'm concerned about what it would actually achieve. We actually looked at this before my time. And it was looked at, maybe Andrew can step in and help me here, because obviously Andrew would have been involved in that. But the Scottish Government looked at this issue and actually decided that it would be disproportionately expensive for what it would achieve in terms of animal welfare concerns. But if I can bring in Andrew, because he would have been involved in it.
Yes, we had discussions with stakeholders when we were preparing for the licensing legislation that we introduced a few years ago, and we did explore the options, and one of the options was having a sort of two-tier system where we'd have registration of people who had one or two litters and licensing of the people who had three or more. It became quite apparent there was a lot of confusion about the difference between registration, which simply requires someone to give their name. That might not be on a public register, it might just be a number where the local authority keep their details, in which case the public can't just see a number, and so there's issues then about checking. There's confusion between that basic registration requirement and licensing, which comes with very stringent license conditions about how the accommodation should be constructed and how bitches should be looked after and restrictions on how they're bred. And those come with inspections by local authority inspectors, periodic renewal of the licence, so that's really quite a stringent protocol. So there's clearly room for confusion for the general public, who wouldn't necessarily understand the difference between a very simple registration requirement and a much more substantial licensing requirement. And as the Minister's explained, we had concerns about the proportionality and putting an enforcement burden on local authorities. There were comparisons made with the dog licence, which was a general requirement but was dropped in the 1980s, basically because it wasn't being enforced, because it was such a low amount that the local authorities weren't enforcing it. So at the time, we came to the opinion that registration, there are some potential advantages, but overall we thought it wasn't a proportionate burden for local authorities. And that's why we didn't take it forward with that licensing legislation.
Something I can usefully, while Andrew was speaking there, I was able to locate what I wanted to bring to this answer as well. Around this sort of like the fraudulent and unlicensed breeders. A register of this type, we don't think would prevent puppies from being sourced from unlicensed breeders. What could confuse or provide false assurance, because there might be confusion with the licensed breeders that have got all the conditions around their license. So if you've got a register, of the house in sort of street, the one litter, just a domestic situation, and they're on a register, there could be confusion in the public's minds that they're like a licensed breeder, mm-hmm. because of a confusion between the two registers and what they actually mean. Mm-hmm. That's a concern.
Okay, thank you. Jim's not going to ask this question. I've got a question in the back of that. So, given the argument you've had and the argument that Andrew Voss has put forward, would you seek to remove that section from the bill? Given that you can't see how it can work in practice, it's going to cause confusion. Would that be something you would, if the bill was to proceed to stage two, would you look for an amendment to remove that?
I think so, yes.
Thank you. Certainly, Rachel Hamilton.
As part of that, does that affect the bill where it says that an unlicensed operator could advertise?
The part of the bill that says an unlicensed...
It within the code of practice. What my understanding is, I just wish I could ask Christine Graham this to clarify it.
But you might have to wait a couple of weeks.
It's around the... that part would not be relevant either.
Yeah, well, we save that question up for Christine, and I don't want to tell you what to do, Miss Hamilton, it might have implications for it, and that's for you to decide. And, of course, I've set out some of our reticence about the registration part in part two. The committee may take a different view.
Because the reason I highlight that is because a lot of the problem surrounds unlicensed people advertising on Facebook, for example. And there was an uptick in online sales in 2019 reflecting that. So if that part was not taken forward. That part is included within it. So, anyway.
Just continue on that theme. Alistair Allen's got a question on the resources.
The committee's had it put to them that enforcing the register would have resource implications. Again, appreciating this isn't your bill, but what's your understanding of what those resources might be for enforcement? What's the cost-benefit? And how would enforcement of the bill relate to enforcement of any existing measures?
Do you know, I thought about this. This is one of the most difficult things to actually put a number on, because I think it would depend on the local authority. Because if you think about the resource implications for like Highlands and Islands compared to, I don't know, Clacks, you know, Clackmannanshire, you know, small geographical area, less people. I think it's a personnel. What would it require in terms of personnel? Or an uplift in personnel if this was expanded to the kind of unlicensed breeders that we're talking about? What boots on the ground would be required for deer patch? You know, what transport costs would be around that as well? So I think that that's a difficult thing to quantify. You would probably get a different answer from every local authority that you asked around this, and some will be more, they might think, oh, we need another full-time equivalent person in the animal welfare team. It could be less, it could be something that they could absorb. I think you'll get different answers, and I don't have a definitive answer on that because of that.
Thank you.
Ariane Burgess.
Thanks, Convener. I heard your concerns about the whole registration scheme, but we've heard from stakeholders that a system of regulation to cover all litters is welcome, but that it would have to sit alongside a user-friendly, easily accessible, centralised and transparent register of anyone breeding and selling dogs in order to be easily enforced. I've heard your bit about, you know, concerns about names and addresses and things like that, but I think it's more about the centralised nature. I think that came up at our previous session, where it's like, you know, it's good to be able to cross-reference on a national basis.
Yeah, and that's, I guess it is a question for the member that's bringing forward the bill. I mean, what she sees in terms of, are you looking at 32 registers that feed into one central database? How would that work? How would they speak to one another? Obviously, you could be from one local authority area travelling to another. Of course, most people are. I mean, you know, you're going to where the dog is that you want to purchase. You want to know that all these databases all speak to one another. It's a question for the member how she sees that working, essentially.
Thank you.
Hey, I'm now going to bring in Christine Graham for questions on the registration scheme.
Thank you, Convener. That's very kind. Do you accept, Minister, that I have actually, from the previous bill, which was introduced but didn't proceed really because of the pressures of COVID, that I've moved from a mandatory regulatory scheme to a discretionary chance for the government to introduce it? And do you accept that I've done that? I think it's explained in the explanatory notes, because with inflationary pressures at the moment and everything, I can understand that we don't want to burden either national or local government, but it's discretionary.
I accept that. So in part two, you're right. It's the form of almost a suggestion. The thing is, Ms. Graham, we already have the powers to put a register in place as part of like previous legislation. But I do absolutely agree with you that the wording of part two does not mean that a register would have to happen. You're just wanting the ability for it to happen. But hopefully I've outlined some of my concerns that maybe you might want to address when you're given evidence and you're taking the bill forward.
Well, if I just move on, because, yes, I accept you register, but this particular bill tries to specify some things in that register. But again, if I take you to section 8, subsection 3, it is may by regulations make provision. So again, it's fairly flexible for government and leaves it into a context of where we are now. Can I ask, therefore, and I accept the issues about data protection. Obviously, I thought about all that. So if I look at section 8, subsection, now where am I going, 4G, which says, as part of it, provision for or in connection with public or other access to registration information, would the minister accept that government got far more resources at hand than I have to consider the legal requirements that would be for this register to give data protection cover, as it were, if I can put it like that, to the transferor and the transferee?
Potentially, but you know, Miss Graham, it's your bill, and you have to answer questions around what information you would like to see in some kind of register. And I think I come back to my question in relation to I think it was Dr. Allen that asked me about what would that register, the information usefully have that was public that would help in terms of the buyer knowing anything about those puppies or the home, the breeder. What would really the registration of those individuals mean in terms of animal welfare and any comfort that a buyer could take from a register existing?
As a supplementary, say, well, what would precede that would have to be complying with the code that I've put into I'm trying to put into primary legislation about considering whether you've got the right breed, etc., etc. That all has to be done in advance. Can I then refer the minister to the, I think it's explanatory notes. I'm doing it's a policy memorandum, paragraph 80, accessing the register. Again, it says the Scottish minister will be able to make provision regarding public or other access to the register. And I don't just read the whole paragraph, but it's there. But further on, it says it is envisaged that specific third parties, such as animal welfare officers and animal welfare organisations, might be given access to registered information in order for them to fulfil their enforcement roles. So it's seen as almost two-tier. So that the position being, if I put the question to you, that if you get somebody that's pretending that they've just had an accident with their bitch and they've got a litter of puppies, if they saw sequence of unregistered, numerous unlicensed litters, alerts would be put. Do you accept that it would be possible to have some limited information for the public, which protects people, I understand that, but would also be access to legitimate charitable organisations, SSPCA, Dogs Trust and so on, Blue Cross, to another level of information to detect whether there's actually covert criminal activity?
Of course I accept that, yeah. I accept that any additional information could help join the dots for any organisation that's involved in enforcement, of course.
The final thing I want to raise is thank you very much for your tolerance. You're well known for it, convener. How bloody controversial. You don't want to patronise. It was interesting that the Minister mentioned multiple providers of the microchipping information. It's a bugbear of mine for a long time. Mm-hmm. Can I ask why we're so long down the road and not actually, which has been promised before, having a Scottish register of microchips, puppies, to which we could also add registration in this case, and to which we could also add owners that have been issued with dog control notices under the Control of Dogs Act. It seems to me this is begging out for joining up, as the Minister's favourite phrase, the dots. So can I ask if the Minister would pursue this with whichever, whether it's the Minister for Justice, whatever, having a central Scottish database? The information's out there. It's just not centralised.
Because that is not in the bill is drafted, it's not something that I have necessarily an answer for.
I'm very tolerant, as Christine Graham suggested. I didn't have very high expectations of how timekeeping would go this morning, but that is out with the realms of the bill, and I don't think you need to answer that.
The only reason I raised it, convener, is because the Minister raised it.
Feel free to respond, Minister.
Well, but I'll finish my responses because that's not been put in the bill. That I, you know, I mean, if that had been something that had been put in the bill, we could have addressed that.
Okay, that's maybe something we can still consider. Okay, I'm going to finally move on to the final section on enforcement. Question from Kate Forbes.
Thanks very much. It's a fairly simple question. I don't know if my mic's on or not, but it is, right. In terms of a question that I put to our stakeholders, that on one hand, governments and decision makers are always inclined to improve behaviour by regulating it further. And one of the risks is always that you bring in more people, of course, to better regulation. But equally, you push bad behaviour even more underground. And if you are including greater costs at various points in the process, how do you ensure that you aren't just enforcing those who are reachable, but you're actually targeting those who might be most inclined to engage in even worse practices in the darkness?
That is a really key question, because I think there's two things as I'm listening to your question I'm thinking of. That on the one hand, quite a lot in this bill, the responsible people will sign up.
Yeah.
Right? How do you enforce finding the people that didn't? I don't know. Impossible. There's another aspect of this, though. If people think that there might be penalties associated with not registering on something, there is another unintended consequence of that, is they might not seek veterinary assistance.
Yeah.
Yeah? So particularly if it's some, like, a household that has, you know, been caught out, as I said, you know, they found themselves with a litter and they just really want to sort of, like, you know, move the litter on amongst the people that they know or advertising or whatever. But they're worried that, you know, the expense around, you know, everything else that they might have to do, they can't afford it. So they might worry that if they took the puppies to the vet for the checkup or whatever, you know, they might get a phone call to the council saying that they're not registered or whatever. Mm. You know, so I think it's complex, and I think we have to take into account that we're not talking about people necessarily that are breeding for an income. It's not a business here, that the up to two litters. We're probably talking about, you know, families here. That is a kind of once, twice in a lifetime experience that they're having with their, they've maybe wanted to just to let their dog have a litter. Something that you do, you know, for selling to people that in your community that you might know. Do you have to then have this sort of, like, onerous? And actually, no. I'll take away that word onerous, because Ms. Graham's not suggesting anything onerous. But what is it really achieving? And then there's the other thing that I keep on coming back to: does being on a register give some kind of false legitimacy to the practice of the welfare issues around the puppies? That's a worry.
Because the risk of giving evidence and not asking a question, the advantage of simplicity is that it attracts more people. But being overly simple might mean that people don't take it seriously with a registration system.
Couldn't have put it better myself.
Do you have any final questions?
Just simply back to compliance. Again, as we all know, this is very discretionary. It's not mandatory. Section 10.1, the Scottish Ministers may, by regulations, make provision for in connection with securing compliance. So just put that. But here, the question here I have is, you're worried about people, you know, who might end inadvertently being caught up in some proceedings or a fine or something. Section 10.2b says, as a recommendation, because it's up to the government, that provision may in particular include provision for the enforcement other than by way of proceedings for an offence of any of the regulations. Would the minister accept? It could just be a warning to somebody to say, look, you should have had this puppy registered. It would depend, but it also leaves it open if the minister would accept to somebody who's masquerading as just an innocent caught out, to somebody who's actually been either used by criminal gangs or is part of a criminal gang. I mean, to me, we must accept that there is an option there other than by way of proceedings. As I say, the regulations be of the government, so these are just sort of guidance to the government.
Yeah, I accept that. I just come back to our issues with part two about what it's actually going to achieve in terms of animal welfare.
With the minister, can I just final question? Really, honestly, the final question. Section 11. How will we know? How will this work? Well, would the minister accept that it's a public awareness and understanding of the relevant regulated regimes that would the minister accept that the purpose of this, and it says this, is to understand registrations under regulations made under Section 8. So within the context of the entire bill, the purpose, would the minister accept, is not about raising awareness before you acquire it, but if registrations proceed, the public are aware that there is a registration scheme and that it would be for the public in a way to police it. If somebody's not registered, you check it out.
I don't really know what to say to that. You're expecting the public to sort of lift up the phone and point to their neighbours that have had a litter of puppies.
Well, it depends on the database, but simply if there is not a registration number, Minister, I put it to you, they would not proceed because it would be a requirement in law that the puppy or dog was registered. And they would say, well, it's not registered. What's this all about?
Thank you.
Thank you.
One final question. So we understand that the government supports the general principles of the bill, but other than education and public awareness, which we don't need legislation to do, what significant policy or legislation will this put in place if it goes through Parliament?
Well, it depends on what shape or form it goes through Parliament. Because obviously there's two parts to the bill, and there's everything that's outlined in the bill. If it goes through in its current form, it would have a registration system for unlicensed breeders, and it would have.
I suppose interrupt. In your opinion, what significant improvement would you welcome that this bill, if passed in its current form, would bring?
A code of practice that is targeted and focused on the decisions and the buying and the advice given to people considering getting a puppy or a dog.
Okay, but that's something you've already got powers to do.
Convener, that's a statement rather than a question. But
absolutely.
Yeah.
Thank you very much, Minister, and thank you for your colleagues today and the time you've taken. That's been very useful. That now concludes our business in public, and we'll move into private session and suspend the meeting for 10 minutes for a comfort break.